Thank you very much for coming, everyone, to our event tonight with Sir Richard Leese. This is an event in conjunction with Warwick Labour, and it's the third part in our series, Labour Moving Forward. We've had Dave Nellist giving the first part, Stephen Kinnock giving the second part, and now Sir Richard is giving the third part. Sir Richard is the leader of Manchester City Council and was knighted for his services to local government in 2008, after the 10-year period after the RRA bombings. And there will be an opportunity for a question and answer session at the end, I think.
Yes.
Yeah. If you have any questions about Labour moving forward or the state of politics, or Sir Richard is also a Warwick graduate, so if you have any questions about that, please feel free to ask them. But without further ado, can we give it up for Sir Richard Leese?
Thanks very much. Good evening, everybody. It's lovely to be back here at Warwick. I did used to be a regular visitor. The business school used to have a local government research consortium. I was on the steering group and indeed chaired it for about 5 years, so I used to come back twice a year, but that's disappeared. So now I'm back in the area. I still have friends in Leamington and Kenilworth, so I come and visit them occasionally. Although I'm going to be back here in 1 month's time, because Labour is having its local government conference at Warwick up at the business school in roughly 4 weeks' time. So I am a graduate of Warwick, not in politics. My degree is in pure mathematics. Obvious qualification for being leader of a council. I started here in 1969, which was, I guess, before all of you were born. I became a councillor in 1984, before I think all of you were born. I became leader of the council 21 years ago, which was before most of you were born, which is really, really making me feel very, very old indeed. When I was undergraduate Warwick, my first year, we had a little bit of political excitement. I was one of the students that occupied the Vice-Chancellor's office back in those days. It's the era of the Warwick files, and an era of, I think, a sort of radicalism we probably don't see anymore. First year I lived in H Block, so I used to wake up every afternoon and look out at Toil in the middle of the square there, and then lived in Coventry overall for 9 years. And when I was an undergraduate, lived at a house in just opposite the Daimler Jaguar factory in the Radford part of the city. The two people I shared with were politics students, and in the 2 years we were in that house, there, I think there's about around six people who lived in the house at various times. Three of them were politics students, the other three all became Labour councillors. I don't know what that says. Either the politics students didn't. So I moved to Manchester in 1979. I'm not from Manchester originally. I was born in Mansfield. And joined the Labour Party really as a result of a move to the left of the Labour Party. The leadership of Michael Foote I found very, very attractive. The British electorate didn't. It didn't go well. But that's why I became a member of the Labour Party, and say fairly rapidly after joining the Labour Party in 1980, became a Labour councillor at a time when we thought we could, through municipal socialism, sweep away the Thatcher Tory government and bring a whole new world to Britain. We tried to do that and failed. It's an interesting lesson in the exercise of power. What we found out was that central government had more power than the local government, and if we wanted to take on central government, then it had to be through subversion rather than through raw power. And it's something I think we tried to do in Manchester ever since. It's whoever is in government, subvert whatever they do to our purposes, which I think on track record we've done relatively successfully over the years. Having said that, I would say that from my point of view, 2016 has been, was rather, not a good year. Brexit, and from my point of view, not good. I was very strongly a supporter of remaining within the European Union. The election of Donald Trump does not fill me with great hope for the future. I did a survey actually when they were still going through the primary stage, where you fill in a questionnaire and it tells you which of the presidential candidates you are most likely to support. Wasn't altogether surprised I came out for Bernie Sanders. Only marginally ahead of Hillary Clinton, but they were both a long, long way ahead, I can tell you, of any of the other candidates on the other side of the divide. Well, I think we've also seen across Europe, if you look at Hungary, you look at Turkey, you look at Poland, a growth of what I'll describe as authoritarian democracy rather than the liberal democracy that I feel more familiar with and more comfortable with, and of course the model of democracy we've been trying to impose on the rest of the world as if we'd had it forever, when actually it's a form that's only existed in this country for a relatively short period of time. But it's a bad year for liberal democracy, a bad year for socialism, I think a bad year for internationalisation as well, and for those who support internationalism, a very worrying year as well. There are large number of commentators, I'm quote the or paraphrase the Economist rather than quote, they're one of many, who suggest that what we've seen over the last couple of years is a change in politics where the divisions are not so much around left or right anymore, the divisions between open and closed. And I think a lot of what we've seen in British politics over the last few years very much represents that. I'll talk a little bit about the Brexit vote, but this is stuff that used to started to emerge certainly before the referendum last year. It's something that's very, very clear in the 2015 general election result, where an assumption was made by many commentators that the growth of UKIP at that period of time, and that was probably a high point for UKIP in the 2015 general election, was more likely to take votes, because they were a right-wing party, they were going to take votes from the Conservative Party, and it was likely to enhance Labour's chances of being elected in 2015. Actually, if you look at the figures, that UKIP actually had far more impact on seats that Labour was hoping to win in order to win that general election than it did on the Conservative Party. What you saw in the places where the Liberal Democrats had been previously strong, Liberal Democrat votes went to the Conservatives, so they were winning seats in the southwest and elsewhere. And in the peripheral areas of the north of England and the Midlands, UKIP were taking sufficient votes to make sure that Labour got nowhere near winning a large number of its target seats. And if you looked at the electoral map post 2015 general election, as you saw effectively the Labour Party had become largely a metropolitan party. It's a party of the cities and the big conurbations, the rest of the country, and I'm not even going to talk about Scotland, the rest of the country was a sea, largely of a sea of blue. So we saw the divisions that became more emphasised at the time of the referendum were becoming pronounced quite a long time before the referendum took place. I think not a lot of attention has been given to who voted how in the referendum, and particularly the Labour Party has spent no time whatsoever analysing what happened in either 2015 or what happened in the referendum. There are people at a national level, people like John Cruddas, who have done actually some really good work in that area, but it's work that's been largely ignored by the party. Far more convenient to have leadership elections every year, at least we raise money through leadership elections every year, than to actually have a serious analysis and debate about what's happening in the political world. But the divisions are actually relatively straightforward. I'm relatively unusual, I'm an old person who voted to remain. The older people got, the more likely they were to vote out, the younger people voted in. Education level, the higher the level of education that people had got, the more likely they were to vote to remain. Conversely, the lesser level of skills, the more likely to stay in. Even things like housing tenure, by and large, the only people who in terms of housing tenure, where there was a majority to remain, were owner-occupiers with a mortgage. The owner-occupiers with a mortgage is quite important. Owner-occupiers that fully own their properties, a majority of those voted to leave. You see how the divisions work. The cities voted to remain, basically where you had a younger metropolitan population, cosmopolitan populations, they voted to stay. By and large, BME communities voted to remain. Not universally, but by and large, they voted to remain. The starkest thing about the referendum were the old industrial areas, where areas to the north of Manchester, areas like Wigan and Oldham, actually areas like big chunks of the West Midlands and where Coventry lies now. Old industrial areas, the areas where our big manufacturing plants used to be, voted overwhelmingly to leave the European Union. There's a question about why did they do that. They're quite clear, there were no economic reasons why they did that. Actually, most of the economic arguments that were put forward during the referendum campaign, partly compounded because both sides lied all the time about the economic arguments or made stuff up, was pretty irrelevant why those areas in particular voted the way they did, and why areas like mine voted the way they did. This was very much a cultural issue rather than an economic issue, and I don't think anybody picked that up particularly during the campaigns, with the possible exception of UKIP, whose argument was almost entirely a cultural argument. It was taking back control of our own borders. It was not about economics. I talked to people in Manchester who were going to vote to leave the European Union. Something they would say quite a lot, particularly older people, is they wanted it to be the way it used to be. It was a yearning for something that they actually imagined they'd had in the past. And if you take those old industrial areas, referred to Mrs. Thatcher once, her government destroyed the industries in those areas, but not only did they destroy the industries in those areas, they also destroy the way of life as well. Everything that went with those industries was gone. And even where they've been successful in getting new jobs, even now, 30 years on, they're often perceived, call centre jobs and so on, as not having the same value as the old industrial jobs that used to be there. And they certainly don't have the same cultural and social life that used to go with those. They don't have the working men's clubs. They don't have the social sports and social clubs, a whole range of other stuff that supported life in those areas. So what you saw is a destruction of the way of life. And for those areas, they look at the impact of globalisation, the new economy that's being created, and they don't see that it's done anything for them at all. So it's important to recognise it's cultural, because if we don't recognise it's cultural, then certainly from my point of view, from the Labour Party, we are not going to address that electorate any time in the future. We saw an enormous schism between the metropolitan and the non-metropolitan areas. We've been able to observe the United States for very many years, where it has become an increasingly divided country. We saw the UK becoming that, and the Brexit referendum result demonstrated that. The question again for the Labour Party is, what do we do about that? I think one thing that's clear about that, and this has been understood for a number of years but largely ignored, is that people do not vote according to policies. So in many respects, manifestos and all that are actually a complete waste of time. They are not what people vote on. People vote on values, and they will vote for those people who they believe most reflect the values that they have. And that, for the Labour Party, was our origins, really. It was about the values we shared with the vast majority of the population, not fairly abstract policies that don't mean a lot to a lot of the people we represent. So also when you look at values, what is important to people in a spatial level? And this is pretty much true of everybody, whatever their background. There is an order: family, street, neighbourhood. Europe and things out there come pretty long way down the list of what's important. But for traditional Labour voters, those things closer to home are far, far more important than for the liberal middle classes that we will see within our cities, who are more prone to be keen on globalisation, internationalisation, and so on. So there is a real value issue that if we want to attract those voters, our traditional voters, that we have to be able to address. I guess that there might be a get out of jail free for the Labour Party. Brexit hasn't happened yet, although we've had a referendum. Indeed, the government has not even pulled the trigger yet. So when we talk about the impacts of Brexit so far, we're not talking about the impacts of Brexit because it hasn't happened. That our economy appears to be doing reasonably well at the moment doesn't mean that Brexit isn't as bad as we thought it was going to be. We still don't know what the impact of Brexit is going to be. And the possible get out of jail free card, and there must be quite a good chance of this, is that the Conservative government, once they trigger Brexit, make such a pig's ear of it, is that anybody will be electable in comparison to them by 2020. I'm not going to put my money on it, though, because, again, one of the things we've discovered about those cultural things, and Trump is a perfect example of this, facts, irrelevant. Nothing to do with how people vote. It's how people feel. And for a lot of people, they felt Brexit. They didn't think Brexit, they felt it. And that is something that will take a long time to be able to address. I suppose in the era of momentum and so on, I said, well, does any bit matter? We're building a movement. We're going to change the nation through the will of the people. Well, actually, yes. The Labour Party was created in order to win elections. It was created in order to win power for the ordinary people of this country. And by and large, if you don't win elections, if you don't have power, you can't do anything. And you certainly can't do anything for the people you represent. So actually, winning elections is really, really important. And if we're going to win elections, it means we have to recognise who are the people we represent, and we need to ensure that we are able to campaign in a way that meets the things I've been talking about. It's about their aspirations, their feelings, what's important to them, their values. And if we're going to win a parliamentary majority, it means that we have to appeal to interests that might, on the face of it, seem quite disparate, because we do have to appeal to those voters, older voters in those old industrial areas. We need to retain that traditional Labour vote, but we also need to be able to appeal to a younger metropolitan electorate as well. We need to be able to appeal to an electorate that is essentially quite socially conservative, and electorate, older people, and an electorate, younger people, who are by and large quite socially liberal. And if we can't do both of those things at the same time, then we're not going to win an election any time soon. So, I'm going to take Manchester as a case study, the city of, because we're quite good at winning elections in Manchester. We actually lost a seat in 2016. Out of 96, it's the first seat we've lost since 2010. So we only now have 95 out of 96 Labour councillors in the city of Manchester. So that's quite good at winning elections. If you look at the demography of Manchester, we're a relatively young city. The south of the city is largely young, professional, well-educated, and so on. The north and east of the city is far more traditional working class. class voters. We win seats in, self-evidently, in both places, because we're winning pretty much all the seats in the city. As a city, we voted to remain in the referendum. Just over 60% of the population of the city of Manchester voted to stay within the European Union. That was the highest in percentage, actually, in the north of England, and the Midlands, actually. You'd have to come down to some of the London boroughs to get a higher percentage for staying in. But same year as there was just over 60% voted to remain in Manchester, over 64% of the population voted Labour in local elections. So we're actually getting a higher percentage of the vote in local elections than were voting for Remain in the referendum. Mentioned the demographic makeup, again, the ability to appeal to a wide cross-section of our population. So, how do we do that? Having said that policies are important, what we managed to do is to maintain progressive policies, because they are important to some people. So for some people, work it out that we've maintained consistently over 30 years very strong policies about equal opportunities, around the cohesion agenda, about an environmental agenda. All of those address the world view of a big chunk of our electorate. And it's not the detail of the policies per se, it is that they will address the world view of a large part of our population. Personally, I think they're important policies as well, but that's in a sense not the point I'm making. But we have consistently maintained progressive policies over a long period of time. Second thing we've done is to listen to people and respond. So instead of sitting in little Labour Party cabals dreaming of wonderful policy ideas that we're then going to impose on our electorate, we spend a lot of time knocking on doors and talking to people and listening to what they say. It's very easy when we talk about some of those old traditional voters, when they start to talk about immigration, partly at times because of the language that they will use, to start labelling those people. And stop labelling those people. We have to listen to them. We have to respond to them. They're not a massive threat. Some of them are racist. The mass of them aren't. We have to think about what they have to say to be able to talk to them about what's important to them. Listen to people. We have to have behaviours that respond to what is important to them. One of the things we did was to demonstrate that we're standing up for Manchester. In an era where the debate was always, are you new Labour or old Labour? We say Manchester, we're not new Labour, we're not old Labour, we are Manchester Labour. That is what we are, that's what we are about. And so we would do things like that when in 2004, Alistair Darling, then Secretary of State for Transport, cancelled Greater Manchester's Metrolink plans. The Labour Party went out into St Peter's Square in the middle of Manchester and demanded his resignation. If there was a Labour government doing things that we did not believe were in the interest of our city and our people, we would say so, and we would say so very, very loudly indeed. In contrast, often been accused since the coalition government came in and the agreements we came to with George Osborne and so on of supping with the devil, which to a certain extent we have been. But that's because our responsibility is to do the best we can for Manchester and Manchester people, and to demonstrate and show that we are doing our best for Manchester and Manchester people. If that means working with the government of the day, even a government that most of us in Manchester will find an abomination. We haven't had a Tory councillor since 1996. Nobody loves tourism. Well, actually, one or two people do, but not many people love tourism in Manchester. But we all work with the government of the day because we want to do the best for Manchester people, and we want to demonstrate we're doing the best for Manchester people. Also, bring things down to what is important to people. I said earlier, most people are concerned with their family, their street, their neighbourhood. So we have to talk to our electorate about those things that are very, very local to them. It's not about having different policies in different places, it's about having a genuine discussion, a genuine dialogue with people. It's something we're trying to take further at the moment through a strategy that we call Our Manchester. And through Our Manchester, it's based on ethnology. It has a very strong sort of theoretical base, but it's about having a different conversation with people, strengths-based conversation, actually asking people, never mind what we can do for you, what can you do for the city, what can you contribute. It is in that way that we engage and have a relationship as a party with people in Manchester that we won't have through sloganising or abstract policies that mean nothing to their everyday lives. 2018, we have all-out elections. Normally we elect in thirds. The likelihood is that we'll lose one or two seats. The idea that we're going to maintain every single seat indefinitely just doesn't happen. It doesn't happen in our politics. It's something I say to my Labour councillors from time to time. If in any given year we can win every council seat, then we can also lose every council seat. And going back into distant history, I can also tell them on one year we nearly did, because in 1968 we lost every single seat bar one on the council. So not only can we do it, there is a history to say that we have done it. And there are a number of things that go with that. Is that we can't become complacent. Hard work is part of our antidote to how we deal with a hostile environment. Can't be complacent, can't be arrogant. Very easy, 95 out of 96 councillors to become arrogant, something we have to guard against all the time. We have to remember that we are servants of the people. We might occupy important roles, but that doesn't make us important people. It's the roles that are important rather than those of us that occupy those roles. I think what it does, is it demonstrates Labour in power. It demonstrates what Labour can do. It demonstrates that Labour can make a difference to people's lives. And one of the things I think the Labour Party generally has to do has to use examples like Manchester, and there are other examples up and down the country, of what difference Labour in power makes. And one of the things I think the party needs to do nationally is to move away from effectively a Westminster centralised London-centric model. And hidden within a lot of things that I said previously during this talk has been the fact that most people in this country do see government, Parliament, Westminster, Whitehall as being remote and out of touch. I think people in this country are very good judges, because I think our Westminster-centric government is, and the opposition are just as bad, are remote and out of touch. The Labour Party ought to be using something it talks about a little bit, but doesn't really do, its grassroots to really get into touch with what is happening in different parts of this country and differentiate between them as well. The UK is not homogenous, it's got lots and lots of variety there. And if we are going to represent the people we're supposed to represent, then we have to have a differentiated approach to that. And that leads to something which I think is really difficult for a party that has always been actually quite a centralising party, is that one of the things the Labour Party needs to do is to grasp devolution. It needs to grasp the fact that power needs to be exercised far, far more at a local level. And Labour parties, I think quite rightly, always had a desire for universality, that everybody gets a share of benefits. What I think they've never quite grasped, indeed no party has until relatively recently, is that if you want similar outcome chances for people in different parts of the country, then you need to do different things in those different parts of the country. If the inputs are the same everywhere, then you get different outcomes. It's inevitable because the areas and the people themselves are different. So if we want everybody to get a really high level of education, then a national curriculum only goes so far. You have to have differentiation in different places. You need to have an education that relates to different job markets in different parts of the country. And all of this means that more decisions need to be made locally. It is largely Labour councils, and actually largely Labour councils in Greater Manchester, that have made the progress, the devolution that has been made over the past 10 years. Say that although the devolution deal that we're currently delivering was signed with George Osborne, actually our first devolution deal in Greater Manchester was signed with Lynn Byrne when he was Chief Secretary to the Treasury before he left his very famous note about there being no money left. He did do something sensible before that, which was to sign a devolution deal. But again, the Labour Party needs to be at the forefront of that, needs to recognise that people are alienated from what they see as a remote elite, and recognise it also has the tools to start dealing with that and addressing that. The heart of this is that I believe that Britain does need a mainstream centre-left party, a party that is capable of representing, as Tony Blair said, the many, not the few. I think we still say it, actually, but the many, not the few. I mentioned Tony Blair, because I suppose what I've not mentioned yet is, other than the fact that we've had two elections, is Jeremy Corbyn. I think the second leadership election was a disaster. It was a complete mistake. I didn't vote for Jeremy Corbyn. Having said that, the last Labour leader I actually voted for was John Smith. Again, I think before most of you were born. I didn't vote for Blair, I didn't vote for Miliband, I didn't vote for Corbyn. It's not stopped me being a loyal member of the Labour Party and trying to make sure that the Labour Party can win power. It's the nature of being a democratic party. That we have a vote. As far as I'm concerned, first time round, Jeremy Corbyn won. He won pretty overwhelmingly. And on the basis of that, that unless something really disastrous happened in between, he'd won the right to lead us into a general election. And I think we would be a lot healthier if we progressed in that particular way. I didn't vote for Jeremy either time, by the way. But even so, I don't think the second time should have happened. And I think it's been very destructive for the Labour Party, and it will take us a little bit of time to recover from that. And for me, as an example of that, Westminster elite being remote and out of touch, playing games that got absolutely nothing to do with the ability of the Labour Party to get a contact with the people we're supposed to represent and to win power on their behalf. So we can rebuild. I think it will take a bit of time. The last time we were in a similar situation to this, it took us, sad to say, 18 years to rebuild. I'm hoping it's not going to take that long next time round, because if I look at what the current government is doing and the sort of policies that they're adopting, certainly the people I represent can't wait 18 years. So I hope we can get our act together. But so ultimately, I think the way we do that is by becoming a grassroots, pro-local party, a devolutionary party. And if I was remotely prone to have any affection for Mao Zedong, I'd say a party that allows 1,000 flowers to bloom, as long as they're blooming, that's all right. It's when they're not that it's not quite so good. And this, for me, offers a way forward. I know what we will do in Manchester, and so we will continue to do what we have been doing. We will continue to be Manchester Labour. We will continue to spend a lot of time talking and listening to people, and we will spend all of our time trying to develop a politics that relates to what those people are saying to us is important to them, that we respond to them rather than impose upon them. I think the Labour Party can do that everywhere, and the Labour Party, I think, becomes a winning party again. That's all I've got to say.
Brilliant.
So happy to take any questions.
Firstly, can we give it up for Sir Richard Leese? Time now for a question and answer session about anything you've heard from Sir Richard there. It can be about his time at Warwick, about Labour, about anything. I'm sure he'll be happy to talk about anything. So has anyone got any initial questions to kick us off for the question and answer session? Don't be shy. Okay. Matt.
So I'm not from Manchester, but from Greater Manchester, from Wigan, which voted 64% to leave. With Paul Nuttall, now leader of UKIP, who seem to be going down the path of a more socially conservative but kind of red UKIP sort of direction. Do you think seats in Greater Manchester are at risk of being taken by UKIP?
Yes, they are, only not in huge numbers. And UKIP doesn't have, notwithstanding Paul Nuttall as a leader, doesn't have the people, doesn't have the resources, actually doesn't have the attitude about campaigning in the way I've been describing. And it's also, I've talked about Manchester, the city, for fairly obvious reasons. But if I look at Wigan, Wigan is 4 or 5 years, they introduced the Wigan deal. They started having those strength-based conversations with the population of Wigan. It's something that's recognised and understood. It's developed a different sort of relationship with the council. So Wigan is an example of a place that I think is trying to do the sort of politics I've been talking about. It's more complicated with, you'll know this, for a borough like Wigan, in that something like 75% of the population of the borough of Wigan would be appalled if you said that they live in Wigan, because they live in Lee or Tilsley or somewhere else. But that's also an example of why they have to have a differentiated politics. They have to be able to talk to people in Lee about Lee and so on. And I think Wigan is a really good example of where the Labour Party is doing that.
Okay, other questions? I suppose one thing I wanted to ask quickly is, I think the report came out, was it from the Fabian Society? Is it called the Fabian Society? Fabian, sorry. About Labour possibly doing a progressive alliance with the Lib Dems, with the Greens, with the SNP. What were your thoughts on that? Because they were basically saying Labour couldn't win a general on its own at the minute.
Our opposition in Manchester for very many years have been Liberal Democrats, and personally I would find very difficult to put the word together, progressive, together with the words Liberal Democrats. Unprincipled, dishonest, I've got a range of words like that. Progressive isn't a word I put with the Liberal Democrats. Nationalism, and I think the SNP are nationalists, and they've adopted effectively a lot of pseudo Labour clothes, because that's the way they're going to appeal to an electorate in Scotland. And they would just as easily be right wing if that's what would appeal to an electorate there, because for them, being Scottish is first and foremost, not social conditions or anything else. So I think I have to ask the questions, to what extent is there a real alliance? Is there a sharing of values around there? And if the electoral arithmetic comes out that you could form a government out of those factors and get rid of a Tory UKIP alternative, then at that point you do it. I don't think that's the starting point of the engagement, though. I think that what Labour should be trying to do is to try and win as many seats as it possibly can, and to be trying to represent a broader section of the population as it possibly can as well. If at the end you get a hung parliament and there are choices of alliances, well then yes, we would do an alliance with the Green Party rather than with UKIP. I think that's self-evident, but that's not the starting point. I think the Fabian Society starting point is that we're losers, so let's get used to it. I don't think that's the right place to be.
So do you think they should stand in every seat then? So if, for instance, in places like Richmond where they could have cost, you know, perhaps a Lib Dem victory, because I assume that Labour would prefer a Lib Dem victory to a Tory victory in places like Richmond.
Well, they might do, but if you look at the coalition government, the Liberal Democrat performance was hardly something that they didn't make any difference, really. Certainly when we went into elections post 2010, certainly one of our lines is vote Liberal Democrat, get Tory, because that's what happened.
Okay. Other questions? Yeah, over there.
I found your comment about how the possibility of losing all your seats in a year sort of avoids, makes your council avoid being complacent. But do you think one party having such total dominance of the council is healthy, and does having a sort of strong opposition within the council improve governance, and how effective and how often are you challenged by Labour councillors?
Okay, good questions. It is a very, so our opposition was Liberal Democrats, so it's a long, long time since we had a good, strong opposition. this serious is that they would always look for basically catchy lines rather than actually seriously looking at what the council was doing. And in many respects, the period of time when we had no Liberal Democrats, scrutiny of the council by backbench councillors was far more serious than had been when you had the Yarboo socks of having opposition parties sitting opposite each other. We've done a lot to increase transparency within the council. Again, this is not peculiar to Manchester, but we've been streaming all our meetings for a couple of years. They're archived, so if you really want to, you can go and look at the last 6 months' committee meetings from Manchester City Council. And actually, people, if there is something on the agenda that a group of people are interested in, that they will go and look at that. Now expect executive members, our cabinet members, have to report twice a year in public to a scrutiny committee. Every council meeting now we have two what term backbench notices of motions. These are unwhipped motions that come. We have a ballot. It's a bit like private members' bills, but. So that has led, again, in the period of the last 5 years, to me losing a vote in the council chamber. That would have never happened when we had an opposition. It happened to be over drugs policy. I believe that the war on drugs has failed and that we need to adopt decriminalisation and so on. It was actually a good debate, but we didn't get a majority within the council. So actually, we probably have had far more serious politics within the council chamber. Since we didn't have an opposition than when we did have one. Is it healthy? Well, we have, I think, 12 different parties standing for election in Manchester. Of the 32 seats, Labour won over 50% of the vote in 31 of the 32 seats. So it's not just simply first past the post. We have an absolute majority in 31 of the 32 seats. So actually, what it demonstrates is that that is what the electorate want. And I think by and large, in our democracy, is the electorate getting what they want is a healthy democracy. It's when they don't get what they want that it's not particularly healthy.
Other questions for Sir Richard? Yes.
What do you think Labour should be saying about immigration?
I'm very pro-immigration, by the way. My city has built its economic revival on immigration, not just international immigration. A lot of our immigration is from other parts of the UK, but international migration is a big part of that. We differentiate between refugees and asylum seekers, where I think the UK, like any other country, ought to be doing its fair share of being able to provide homes for refugees and asylum seekers. I don't think we've been doing our fair share, certainly if you look at what other countries in Europe have been doing. In terms of economic migration has got to be economic. This is about people coming to work. So the sort of policies that say people can come here to work, but by and large, until they've worked for a period of time and have built up a certain amount of credit, they can't benefit from the welfare state, is where I would be around that. One of the most foolish bits of this government's immigration policy is around students and international students, where I would have a completely open door for international students and would guarantee that for a period of time that they're able to work in this country after they've graduated as well. And the current policy is just saying no to talent in what is internationally a very competitive market.
Other questions? Yeah, just over there.
Hi, I was really interested in the fact that you said you were a very staunch Remain supporter, and then of course you're very pro-immigration and everything. And then your support for devolution in the fact that, you know, in the EU referendum, we were essentially arguing against people who were arguing to take back control. So relative Europe to versus the UK to govern itself more locally. So why do you think that's a different argument?
There is an argument about immigration, economic migration, and so on is one thing. I think there's another argument which is about access to markets, about how we trade, how we survive, and so on. Having said that, most of the population weren't influenced by economic arguments, because where my values and stuff like that was. I think in terms of market, that having tariff-free access to what is the biggest market in the world is relatively important to us and our economic future. Having said that, not just within the European Union, but elsewhere through the World Trade Organization and so on, there is a very powerful argument that governments have not regulated those markets particularly well. Where I think we ought to go is a narrative that accepts that in this country millions of people have been let down by globalization. That has been a failure of governments to effectively regulate those markets, and that what we ought to be doing is managing those markets in such a way that people do get benefits, that there aren't people being left behind. But I think that's the place where we ought to go, rather than say, well, actually, we're just going to switch off the tap completely.
Yeah, but I just mean that, you know, for a lot of people it was about, you know, local governing and not letting the people over there govern in the way that you're talking about Westminster and governing locally in Manchester.
Well, I don't know. I think that the real phrase about taking back control of our borders was very much not about local government.
Right, but for a lot of people it was about not letting Brussels.
Which is the way it was translated electorally was into taking back our borders. If you want to get into a detailed argument about the impact of Brussels versus Westminster, what the electorate voted for was Westminster rather than Brussels, even though there is lots of evidence that in terms of unnecessary regulation, Westminster is a far worse culprit than Brussels is. And again, it's an example of people were voting on the notion of a particular value set, not on the factual evidence to underpin that. But what they voted for was not for local, it was for Westminster to have the control.
Okay, other questions? Yeah, Ben.
You spoke of increased devolution, but if you look at the electoral turnout for local elections versus Westminster elections, do you think the electorate is ready or will be ready for the everyday man on the street? Are they ready for more elections where they actually have to consider it because it will matter more?
I don't think we're talking about massive amounts of additional elections, and Greater Manchester, like the West Midlands, is one of the places that will have a directly elected mayor from May this year. And in terms of the number of elected politicians, well, in Greater Manchester we got rid of one, the police commissioner, to replace, so actually the number of elected politicians stays exactly the same, and as we don't have a police commissioner election anymore, the number of elections stays exactly the same as well. So we've developed a model that doesn't increase the number of politicians, doesn't increase the amount of elections, but it does actually have a higher level of devolution than anywhere else in the country, including London, and Greater Manchester, through its devolution deal, has more powers. To what extent does that resonate with ordinary people? I think the answer to that at the moment is not a lot. I think the question is, will it in the future? And if I take an example of Bristol, where Bristol went for a and elected mayor, I think in 2012, just for the city, and the turnout was pretty appalling in the 2012 election, and they elected a very interesting independent candidate to be mayor of Bristol. 4 years later, the turnout doubled, because I think what had happened in between was that the electorate worked out that this made a difference, and it made a difference to Bristol. And certainly, I expect to see the same in Greater Manchester, not least because for local government over the past 35, 40 years, by and large, in many places, the number of reasons to vote for local government went down because government took more and more power away from local government. When people see it is local politicians making decisions that impact on their lives, then I think you see a reversal of that process. But it won't, again, it won't be done on an abstract basis. It will only happen when people see those decisions being made, not when you're talking about them in advance.
Okay, other questions? Yep, down the front.
You talked a lot about sort of grassroots movements and going to local areas, you know, very sort of focusing on what neighbours would be there to see. What would you say the leader needs to do then? What's still going on? Do they need to be focusing on how do they appeal Labour? Because they can't appeal Labour to every tiny little area of Great Britain, so how, what message do they need to be sending?
Well, I'm tempted to ask the question, why not? I think that's got to be the objective, is to try and appeal to everybody. But will Jeremy Corbyn ever appeal to the members of the Quorn Hunt? Probably not. Again, there is still, I suppose, some room, even in what I've said about responding to people's values, for a little bit of evangelism within this as well, that we are trying to sell ideas as well as simply respond to what people are saying. I think what Jeremy needs to do, what the leadership needs to do, I don't think it's just Jeremy, I think it's a real danger to fall into the trap of what the media would like us to do, to make it completely about national personalities rather than anything else. But I think what the Labour Party needs to do is to reinvigorate its grassroots. It needs to become perhaps rather more regional. It's already done that with Scotland, where the level of policy autonomy that Scotland has got now is perhaps rather more reflecting the politics of Scotland. Perhaps about 15 years too late, but even so, that's going to happen. I think that's going to have to start happening in England as well. That we have to have space for a slightly different politics in the north of England, where I am, than to what you would have in London and the London and the South East. And I think that's what the leadership of the Labour Party needs to be doing, saying it's not about the National Policy Forum, it's not about Westminster and what goes on there. This is what we are doing differently in different localities. And I think that's the sort of leadership we ought to be getting from the National Party.
Okay, we still have time for a few more questions. If anyone's got any. Yep.
When cohesion seems to be like the main problem for Labour, how can we make a pro-local approach, like you're saying, to listen to the people, when there's so many diverse values across communities in Britain? How can we make that work nationally?
I think what you have to do is to look for those values that are shared values, and I think there are some shared values, and I think there are some things that underpin shared values as well. The most important of that is language, and I by that I don't mean just that we get everybody to learn English, although I do think we ought to get everybody to learn English. And indeed, going back to your immigration refugee and asylum seeker type question, one of the things that we should do is both expect anybody to learn English, but also put the provision on so that people can learn English. And I've talked to other cities in Europe, places like Vienna. When refugee and asylum seekers arrive there, they start learning German day one, and it's put on by and funded through the Austrian government. And that's probably not the most liberal place at the moment, Austria, but that's the approach they take. But it's actually developing a common common language, so that when we use words, we by and large try and mean the same thing when we use the words. So, but then. What other things are important to people? I think there is a very strong strand in this country of fairness, that we ought to live in a fair country. So I think the Labour Party ought to be about fairness. I think there's a very strong strand in this country about basically being free to do what you want to do, as long as it doesn't impinge negatively on other people. So I think freedom ought to be something that the Labour Party ought to be associated with. And I think that's about how we reflect diversity around the country. It's looking at those core values that are likely to be shared values. Now, even then, I sit occasionally in London with a room full of some Labour councillors and loads of Tory councillors, and it's slight problem here that when I use the word fairness and when they use the word fairness, we don't mean the same thing. So actually, we do need to say what we mean by fairness as well. But I think that's ultimately where we go. It is that value-driven approach.
Okay, other questions? I think I'm neglecting the side slightly, so we go right at the back there.
My question's about the upcoming Midland mayor elections in May. Are you concerned that the Tories will be able to claim the Midlands, given that Birmingham kind of bucked the trend and voted to leave compared to a lot of the big cities in the UK, the Black Country and the West Midlands as a whole voted resoundingly to leave when they are genuine Labour heartlands? The Labour Council is running a huge deficit. There's been a lack of infrastructure investment across the previous government and also the Labour government beforehand. And Birmingham, I believe, is the youngest city in Europe, but it's got the highest youth unemployment. The Tories have fielded quite a strong candidate in the John Lewis CEO, who brought John Lewis as part of the Grand Central plans to Birmingham. And Labour seems to have fielded quite a weak candidate in comparison. As a Labour Party, are you concerned that the Tories are going to get in there when that really should be a genuine Labour win?
Well, let's go back to your question. Is I'm concerned if the Tories win anywhere. I would be concerned about the Tories winning in the West Midlands. And I think you're underplaying the Labour's candidate in the West Midlands. He's got a track record as a Member of Parliament, as an MEP. So actually, it's some real political experience to the extent to which the Tory candidate doesn't have. So I think there are strengths there. I'm not going to comment on the performance of Birmingham Council or any of the other councils in the West Midlands. Both the current and previous leaders of Birmingham have all been friends of mine, but it's not my job to talk about what they do right and what they do wrong. But yeah, I would be concerned about losing the West Midlands in the election.
Other questions on this side? Yep.
Are there any specific reasons why you didn't vote for Jeremy Corbyn either time?
My view is that whatever his political beliefs, that he doesn't have the leadership capabilities to do what he's doing with the Labour Party to make it electable again. So it is rather more about leadership qualities than his personal politics, a lot of which I would agree with.
Okay. Other questions? Yeah, at the back.
You talked about being the leader of the council, but obviously being voted down on a few motions. What do you think the Metro Mayors as a whole are going to do for that kind of, for the collective, rather than having a single figurehead? Do you think that's going to be damaging to the city or to the parties?
No, I don't think it is, but that's because the model that we've developed in Manchester for the elected mayor, and it's one that's been adopted by the West Midlands and other places, it's very, very different to the two-tier London model, in that in our model, the mayor is the 11th member of the combined authority. They're not separate to the combined authority. And on everything other than police, that even where they have executive powers, and the executive powers of the mayor are actually quite limited, they can still be outvoted by a two-thirds majority of the rest of the combined authority. So I think we've built a far more consensual model of politics, which I think means our chances of being able to go forward in
in a coherent and cohesive way, that much greater, if that makes sense.
You don't think there'll be any chance of Boris Johnson happening?
Given that we know who the candidates are in Greater Manchester, not in Greater Manchester.
In the future, there's
every chance, but I think we have developed a governance system which is pretty much idiot-proof, really, so that if we do get a Boris Johnson, that we will be able to manage that position and make sure that we don't just go off doing daft things and behaving in a daft way.
Okay, final question there.
How do you suppose Scottish Labour sort of reclaimed 40 plus seats that lost in the 2050 election, especially given that it's no longer the official opposition and Ruth Davidson has led Scottish Conservatives to become the opposition?
In some respects, I'd have to say, I haven't got a clue. I'm pretty certain it's not going to happen any time soon, because the SNP have stolen a lot of Labour's territory in Scotland. I do know, again, I know the leader of Glasgow relatively well, that they are working really, really, really hard. But I think what you saw in Scotland was the complete antithesis to what I've been saying about a Labour Party that needs to work hard and be in touch with the people it represents. We had a Labour Party that was completely out of touch and took the Labour votes for granted. And ultimately, I think that's why we lost Scotland. It was not a revival of nationalism per se. It was the SNP that were doing all that stuff of knocking on doors and listening to people. And actually, SNP, which probably 10, 15 years ago was a right of centre party, became a left of centre party because that's what people in Scotland said they wanted to hear. Labour Party wasn't doing that. So there is no magic bullet for Labour in Scotland. What I think there is a very long and hard road back that's going to involve a lot of hard work over very many years. They've lost trust. It's a lot easier to lose trust than it is to gain trust.
Okay, can we give it up for Sir Richard, please?
Thank you. Thank you to Warwick Labour for co-doing this event with us, and thank you to Warwick TV for filming the event. It will be up on YouTube afterwards. On Tuesday, tomorrow, we're joined by Peter Hitchens for a talk about he doesn't think there's been a war on drugs. If you want to come along to that, it's at 6 o'clock in L5, which is next to the Student Cinema in the Science Concourse opposite the library. And it's going to prove to be a very interesting talk. Starts at 6 o'clock. And on Thursday, we have an event with the Warwick Tories. It's with Sam Bowman, who's the Executive Director of the Adam Smith Institute, about how free markets can help the poor. That is in SO13, which is in the social sciences, at 6 o'clock as well. But one last time, we'll be up first.